Okay, I'd like to welcome you tonight. We are the Beaverton Historical Society, and we do monthly presentations on the second Tuesday of every month. It's not always here, that's obvious. we also share with Elsie Stewart. So next month on the 9th, of April is going to be Lake Oswego Heritage House, and they're going to talk about the history of Lake Oswego, which has a huge connection to part of my family, and that's not why they're coming. But anyway, and then in May, we're having the Oregon Historical Society, and they're going to talk about Portland history. And I don't know how many of you know about the plank road that went between Beaverton and Portland back in the 1800s. Well, at our little space over on First Street in Beaverton, we have two of those planks that they dug up out of Farmington Road. And so they're going to talk about that, and they're also going to talk about the elk down there that has water coming out of it, and everybody thinks, oh, maybe it's a fountain, but that's really where they used to water their horses. So I'm not going to tell you anymore because I'll take her story away. So there is a suggested $2 donation tonight. It would be great if you could do that, and if not, that's fine. We won't kick you out. And we have cookies up here as well, and if you have email or, you know, address and phone number and you'd like something in the mail, we have a sign-up sheet as well. And with that, I'm going to introduce Michael. It's a great presentation, and I'm glad you came. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming. I hope you will excuse me for being seated during the presentation. As you may have seen, I'm handicapped and can't stand for a long presentation anymore, though I did it for many years. I'm happy that at least tonight the weather hasn't conspired against us by snowing, which it did the original time we had this scheduled. We have a bit of rain tonight, but you've all braved it and you're here, so thank you so much. I'm here to tell you about my new book, which has been published in the past year, called Oregon, A State That Stands Out. And since I was here last, I have been told that this won an honorable mention at the London, England Book Festival in worldwide competition. And everybody who tells me they've read it has enjoyed it a lot. So it's supposed to be a fun book. The book counters the prevalent impression that many would get from reading the major media in the Portland area that poor Oregon is a state that simply can't do anything right. Well, that is not only true, I mean false rather. What is true is that for a long time, the state of Oregon has been heralded at the national level as a state that does many things right and has gotten lots of plaudits for it over the years. This book includes some 500 facts about the way in which the state of Oregon does stand out from the national point of view. Now, others have written books and articles about the best of this or that in the state of Oregon. This book is different. It looks at the state from the national point of view. And we find in this book that Oregon is either the top state in the nation in various categories or among the top states. And I'll touch upon a few of them in my presentation tonight. Now, over the years have certainly been minuses as well as pluses. I'm not pretending that Oregon is a perfect state, but compared to many states, it has done a lot of things right, and today I submit that the pluses far outnumber the minuses. And for quite some time, people have been flocking to the state of Oregon. In fact, the New York Times, among other Eastern media, keeps finding things to praise Oregon for, or Portland for. It may even be time to give more serious attention to our late Governor Tom McCall's warning about trying to attack too many people to the state. Well, let's begin by looking at a few salient facts about Oregon's geography. Oregon has the deepest lake of any state. It has the deepest canyon, which it shares with Idaho, the Hell's Canyon. It has the most waterfalls of any state. It has the longest coastal sand dunes of any place on the American coastline. The most water that flows into the Pacific from a river on the North American continent is the Columbia River. And the most water that flows over a waterfall that's entirely within the United States flows over Willamette Falls. We're rarely told that. The most species of conifers are found here. And three nationally admired gardens are found in Oregon. Well, that's just a sampling of what's in the book under the geography. There are a number of points about its history that are worth recalling too. For three centuries before the pioneers arrived in the Oregon Trail, merchant seamen and explorers were coming along the Oregon coast. Many of them were Spanish galleons coming from the Philippines and going across the Japanese Current, as it was then called, and bumping up against Oregon's coast and then sailing south to Mexico. Some of them stopped here to get water and other supplies, and some were shipwrecked here. We have an awful lot of names of Spanish origin along the Oregon coast for that reason. And the influx of settlers on the Oregon Trail, it has often been reputed by historians to have been one of the largest migrations that was voluntary in nature of anywhere in the world. That was from 1840 to 1860. When I say voluntary, I mean it wasn't caused by war, famine, or pestilence. They chose to do it. And some structures from the Oregon Trail times still survive. I've got a picture of photograph of one of them in the book. Also, Astoria was the first English-speaking settlement west of the Rockies, 1811. The very first of them. It wasn't California, it was here. The first cattle drive in the far west was to Oregon in 1837. And in 1843 at the conclave at French Prairie, the early settlers decided by just one vote to try to become part of the United States. And of course, they succeeded, and that's what we are now, Americans. They started out the process there. And Oregon City was the first incorporated American city west of the Mississippi. Little Oregon City, 1844. And for a while, it had the only federal courthouse on the West Coast, 1848. And Astoria had the first American post office and customs house west of the Rockies, 1847 and 1852. And as Oregon developed as a state, it began to set all sorts of national records. For instance, it built the first high-tension power line in 1889, running from Oregon City to Portland, the very first in the entire country, was right here. And then Portland put in the first electric streetcars on the West Coast, the first federal wildlife refuge in the West was set aside in Oregon in 1907, at Three Arch Rocks on the coast near Tillamook. And in the era of the late 19th century, all sorts of colorful things happened in Oregon. For instance, as the pioneers were building cities and putting in railroads and building steamboats, believe it or not, Indian wars were still going on in eastern Oregon. This was against Chief Joseph in the Wallowa Valley in the late 1870s. And also in eastern Oregon, a few decades later, range wars broke out between those grazing cattle and those grazing sheep, wreaking devastation. Barns were burned and fences uproared. 10,000 sheep were killed in the range wars. They went on and on until the federal government intervened. And a little later, 1908 to 1912, the last of the railroad wars broke out between competing railroad magnates who were building competing railroad lines down each side of the Deschutes River. And people got killed, and rails got torn up, and all sorts of mayhem took place there. The last one in the country. And when Oswald West was governor in the period 1913 and 14, he closed down a wide open mining town along the Snake River, Copperfield, sent in his militia, and imposed martial law, and successfully, and his secretary, a young lady, was in charge of it all, and it survived challenge in the courts. And after that time, the town burned and practically disappeared, Copperfield. And filing fraudulent claims for the public domain became an epidemic in Oregon in the period between 1905 and 1910. It caused Teddy Roosevelt, when he was president, to send in the Secret Service and federal lawyers to prosecute all the then top officials in the state, and most of them were sent to prison. Most of them were also, incidentally, Republican, so we had a Republican president doing that. And somewhat earlier, in 1892, Oregon had a tart-tongued populist governor, Sylvester Poneyer, who characterized incoming President Grover Cleveland, a Democrat, as, quote, a Wall Street plutocrat, unquote. And in the book, there are a number of his marvelous quotes. And in 1874, shipwrights in North Bend, just north of Coos Bay, built a clipper ship that set records in making a speedy passage to England. It was a ship built in Oregon then that made those records, not one built in New England, here. Shanghaiing was then going on in Oregon ports, and Portland claimed to have the world's longest bar. Erickson's on Lower Burnside, it styled itself as, quote, the rowdiest working man's bar in the country, unquote. It was a block long on both sides of the building. It burned about 1913, but, and today Oregon has more ghost towns than any other state and the most covered bridges. Now let's look at a serious point. In the Progressive Era, between 1902 and 1919, Oregon led the way with many innovations in governance and social policy, with the initiative, the referendum, the recall, the direct primary, women's suffrage, and the Corrupt Practices Act, and also on wage and hour laws to protect workers, some of which got challenged to the Supreme Court and upheld. All of these came to be called, quote, the Oregon system, unquote. And many other states followed Oregon's lead. The state was widely celebrated throughout the nation for all of these innovations in governance. And in recent years, Oregon has picked up that tradition again. It led the nation once more, for instance, in adopting the practice of voting by mail. It now has the highest percentage of its adults voting each year, the highest in the entire country. Also, before Obamacare passed, Oregon had its own health plan that improved the coverage of medical insurance for all, the Death with Dignity program, and many others, a long list. They're in the book. That does suggest that we tarry a moment to talk about health care and education and crime in Oregon. Nowadays, Oregon is setting the pace in looking after the health of its citizens. It has the lowest rate of premature births in the entire nation. It's top ranked in the way it looks after the health of its children. It has the lowest rate of childhood obesity. In the way it feeds poor students, it is ranked as either outstanding or in some years at least as satisfactory. It's also top ranked, it's in the top tier of states in the amount of exercise its citizens get. And now over 90% of the citizens of the state of Oregon have health insurance. It's also top ranked in the way it looks after its citizens who need long-term care. And Oregon gets a very bad rap for education. But let's look at the facts. The percentage of those getting college educations in Oregon is higher than the national average. And its high school graduates are meeting college readiness benchmarks at levels higher than the national average in math, science, and reading. On the matter of crime, Oregon puts fewer of its people in jail. Again, you wouldn't get that impression from the television. Oregon is among the one-third of the states having a low rate of incarceration. Among other things, this reflects its lower rates of murder and violent crime here. Low rates. And more of its people give to charity than the national average. Since the book was written, we've been ranked as among the top 10 in the country for that. Well, you may say, all those things may be true, but how about its record on business? Now, I tend to cite authorities in each line of business, and that's true for business too. For instance, the publication Bloomberg thinks that Oregon has the best performing economy in the country. Bloomberg says that. It considers a whole batch of factors in making that judgment. Oregon also leads and the relative size of its manufacturing center, or sector rather. Oregon is also one of the two states with the highest number of patents per employee for inventions. Forbes magazine, another business journal, says Portland is one of the best cities for business. And since 2007, when they had that big recession, Oregon's GDP growth per capita has been the second greatest in the country. Now, Oregon is also among the states having the lowest taxes, considering all of them, not just cherry-picking this or that. And this includes taxes on business, very low rates. And its level of property taxes is below the national average. And it has one of the fastest rates of growth in personal income. It's one of the top states in terms of job growth. And more workers here also joining unions. It also has one of the highest minimum wages, which will soon go to $15 an hour in major metro areas, which is also indexed to keep up with inflation. And its public pension system has one of the top earning records in the country. Again, you'd not get that impression from the Oregonian. And historically, businesses here have been known across the country. For instance, Astoria was once the fishing capital of the world, of the whole world. Oregon is still the state producing most lumber, despite the big fall down. Plywood was invented here. White Stag introduced skiing clothes to the country and became the largest producer. Janssen became a leading producer of swimwear. And in the 1930s, Meyer and Frank, our department store for a long time, became the largest retail outlet west of the Mississippi. That didn't last a long time, but it happened. And during World War II, Portland was regarded as, quote, the liberty ship capital of the country, unquote. Now, it's true, many other ports had shipbuilding yards, but this had the greatest conglomeration of them of all. Might add, my late wife worked in the shipyards and her mother was a welder. And today, Portland is the nation's largest wheat export hub. And Portland is the second most active center on the West Coast for hauling and distributing freight. Its airport is usually ranked as the top airport in the entire country, and it's held that status for 15 straight years, right up to now. Oregon also has many top-rated golf courses, you know, south of Coos Bay. Powell's is now the world's largest retail bookstore. And Wheaton and Kennedy is the largest independent advertising agency in the country and the most honored one. It's gotten all sorts of awards. But, of course, Oregon's economy is driven most by being foremost in two categories. The world's largest producer of athletic shoes is here, Nike, with most of its competitors gathered here as well, to make Oregon what has been described in the press, quote, as the global epicenter for athletic apparel. The global epicenter. Right here in our midst. And Oregon is also a world center for fabricating computer chips servicing the needs of the computer industry. A knowledgeable spokesman for a recent governor has said that Oregon is, quote, the dominant high-tech manufacturing center in the world, unquote. In Washington County, nearby here, or I guess we're in it, Intel has built the largest collection of chip-producing plants in the world, and many others in that field have also clustered about. Now, this is relatively well known, but it is not well known that Oregon plays a major role in other industries too. For instance, did you realize that Oregon plays a major role in the aircraft industry? Boeing assembles its plants up around Puget Sound, it has manufacturing plants for aircraft parts all over the world. But of all of its plants, its very largest of all is right here in Gresham, Oregon, where it produces engine mounts and airframe wings. And other plants around Western Oregon do too. Precision Cast Parts long played this role. And there's an outfit down in Albany that does too, ATI Pacific Cast Technologies. And in a different field, rail cars, Greenbrier in Clackamas County is a world leader in producing rail cars, heavy, big steel rail cars right here in Oregon. And a firm in Eugene pioneered the development of barcoding devices, spectrophysics scanning systems, and it now dominates the world market, a Eugene industry. And Oregon industries also manufacture products for the Defense Department, such as aerospace platforms for the space industry, manufactured right here in Oregon. And the list is too long to go on. But before I leave business, let me say a word about Oregon's agricultural sector. It's changed its focus. Now the nursery trade is the leading component of its agricultural sector, with a focus on flowers, shrubs, and ornamental trees. And as to food, its focus there is on wines and specialty crops. Can you believe it? Olive oil is now produced in Oregon and bottled here. To some extent, Western Oregon is now beginning to resemble Northern California, with its wines and cheeses winning worldwide awards. And I might add that Oregon is a national leader in selling its crops locally in farmers markets. Along with Vermont, it leads the nation. Well, and all the while Oregon was developing a dynamic new economy, it was also becoming a leader in cleaning up its environment and conserving nature. It's widely considered to be the greenest state in terms of having programs to protect its environment. Oregon was the first state, for instance, to set up an agency to clean up its air, the very first in the entire country. It was the first state to actually clean up a major river. It's the only state with a statewide system of land use planning. It was the first jurisdiction in the world to ban CFCs to protect the ozone layer. Those are chlorofluorocarbons. Oregon was the first state to adopt a mandatory bottle deposit law, which has cleaned up litter along our highways. It was the first state to set pollution limits for smoke from wood stoves. Now it has the strongest restrictions on the levels of toxic chemicals permitted in its waters and rivers. It's among the top states in terms of recycling, energy efficiency, installed wind capacity, and in its reliance on renewables. And since I wrote this book, Oregon's legislature has gone even further to plan on phasing out all sorts of carbon fuels by 2022. And with respect to conserving nature, Oregon was a pioneer in protecting its beaches and assuring public access. Oregon has the most federally designated wild rivers, where dams are not allowed. In one way or another, 27% of its forests have been reserved from logging. 18% of its national forest land has been set aside as wilderness. Environmental protection is now a core value for most Oregonians, but they all do understand that we must keep facing new challenges as they come along. And some of its industries also help. Oregon now hosts the nation's largest plant producing solar panels and its only plant producing streetcars. And it also hosts the U.S. offices for the largest producer of wind turbines generating electricity. But all the while these things were happening in business and in the environment, culture and entertainment have been thriving in Oregon as well. Its music, live theater, public television, and restaurants are drawing plaudits. For instance, a performance of the Oregon Symphony in New York City not long ago was called pretty extraordinary, unquote, by the New Yorker. The New York Times says Eugene's Bach Festival is, quote, the best of its kind in the country, unquote. The Oregon Repertory Singers won the highest score for artistry, the highest one in the entire nation. Its Sleater-Kinney band has been called, quote, the greatest rock band in America, unquote, by of all things, the New Yorker. That was recently. Oregon Shakespeare Festival in Ashland recently won a Tony Award. Portland's Rose Festival has been named, quote, as the best in the world, unquote, by the International Festival and Events Association. And Oregon Public Broadcasting has won both a Peabody Award for news and an Emmy for drama, and its public broadcasting services are now the most used of any PBS station in the country. You know, the number of programs are produced here, such as Rick Steves and there are another half dozen or more of them. They're picked up and shown all over the country. And Oregon Public Broadcasting also, on a per capita basis, draws the most public support of any PBS station in the country. We do a good job in supporting our public station. And Portland's Public Library has the highest per capita use in the country. And on the same basis, Portland has the most movie theater seats per capita in the country too. And movie studios keep making their films in Oregon, with over 250 having been made here. Portland also has the most breweries for craft beer of any city in the world. Right here, not in Europe, here. And Portland has been called quote, the great new American food city, unquote, with many of its chefs winning the coveted James Beard Award at the national level. And its food carts are celebrated. It's almost hard to believe that experts in the East rave so much about Portland and Oregon, but they do. I've set it forth in this book. Well, it is true that they rave less about Oregon's universities, but a former education editor for the New York Times, Lauren Pope, has called Reed College, quote, the most intellectual college in the country, unquote. And its main universities rank high among the nation's top research universities. But it's in sports that they do excel. The University of Oregon team has played in the Rose Bowl 7 times, winning in 3. It was only a few years ago that it was rated as number 2 in the nation. And altogether in recent decades, it's played in 19 bowl games. And many are hoping that with a new coach, that Oregon will get back on that winning track again. Oregon State has been to the Rose Bowl 3 times, winning 1. But quarterbacks for both institutions have won the coveted Heisman Trophy, which few other states can say. Nearly 80 football players from Oregon colleges have now gone on to play for professional teams. Oregon State's baseball team won the national championship in 2006 and 2007. Portland's professional basketball team, the Trail Blazers, won the national championship in 1977. Its professional soccer team, the Timbers, won the national championship in a number of years, most recently in 2015. Its professional women's soccer team, the Thorns, won it in 2013. But it is in track and field events that the University of Oregon is most noted. It won the NCAA championships in both 2014 and 2015. Under legendary coach Bill Bowerman a while back, the U of O won 22 NCAA championships. Under him, 31 of its athletes went on to win Olympic medals. He, of course, is one of the founders of Nike. Other Olympic winners have come from Oregon, too, with gold medal winners, particularly in swimming and skiing. I should add that in mountain climbing, a mountain climber from Oregon was on the first American team to climb Mount Everest, Willie Unseld, who I knew. And incidentally, Mount Hood is the most climbed major mountain in the United States, right here. Well, it's time for me to wind up. It's a fact that Oregon has now arrived at a new level of excellence. It's attracting attention from qualified authorities and is being given high marks. While it is far from perfect, the recognition it is getting is simply astonishing. And its new economy has emerged while it has been forging a role as an environmental leader. The two do seem to be compatible. I submit that Oregon's new stature should be celebrated, and more information keeps coming along since I wrote the book. If we have time, I'd be glad to share that with you. Thank you very much, and I'll be glad to answer questions and sell copies of this book.
Thank you. Say that Oregon is the greatest exporter of wheat. Is that because the Midwest is shipping the wheat to Oregon and then it sails out to?
I think most of the Midwest wheat is shipped out of the Great Lakes and the river there that goes to the Atlantic, at Duluth. Ours is all from the eastern Washington wheat fields, but the Columbia doesn't run to Puget Sound, so
right.
comes here. I don't know how. I suspect that there's some distinction there, but my authorities have said that about Portland as a export hub.
Okay.
We can double check that. You'd like? Any other good question? That was a very good one. Yes.
Do you know anything about the Boston mill down in the shed?
Yes, I've run across that for a different book, but in writing this book, I checked that out, but I couldn't. There was also one down in the Rogue River Valley, but I couldn't find any facts about them that caused them to stand out from a national point of view. Do you have some facts about that?
It's still running as a tourist attraction.
Yes, it is. I think it's just State Parks Department has some.
Is that the one that's somewhere near Albany?
Yes, south of that. It's one of those small towns south of the east side of the valley.
I did some electrical engineering on that facility.
Yeah.
And it's very much active. It's super. But one of the problems is needed water available for fighting fires.
Okay.
And there's a small canal that goes through there, but during the summertime it ran fairly dry.
Well, I think it's significant as a survival in the state of Oregon from that point of view, but this particular book is not just about Oregon history, it's about these different facts from a national point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So I think both things are right, they're just different contexts. Anybody else like to? Yes, please.
I've heard that Oregon played a part in the Civil War, that we actually sent troops to.
Well, what happened is, first of all, I will say that, this is in the book, let me turn to that section. There's a section on the wars and military, and there are a number of very good points about that. I'm sorry, Roland Wars, 86, okay, here we go. The only U.S. Senator killed as a soldier in the Civil War hailed from Oregon. It was Senator Colonel Edward Baker, killed in 1861 at Ball's Bluff, fighting on behalf of the Union. He was the only member of Congress to die in the war.
Wow. Is that Baker City, Oregon?
Yes.
Yeah.
And the last bit of frictions connected to the Civil War that occurred in the country was outside of Eugene, in the Long Tom area, where some Southern sympathizers were creating friction and fired some bullets, and the federal troops were sent in. Well, basically, during the Civil War, Oregon's own militia took over from the federal troops that were stationed in Oregon's frontier areas and guarded the new settlers, and federal troops went off to fight in the east and the south. And then they returned here afterwards. Phil Sheridan, for instance, afterwards was stationed out here. So I might add that I found, if you allow me to, I'll read a paragraph or two. Well, during the Spanish-American War, Oregon's 2nd Volunteer Infantry Regiment was federalized in 1898 and sent to the Pacific Theater. It was among the first to land in Guam and accepted surrender. It was the first to land in the Philippines on the island of Manila, and then quickly secured it. Then it went on to secure the city of Manila. And then it was involved in the long insurgency afterwards. And had many firsts. And if you're interested, a long section here on the Second World War, but you want me to go on to that? Oregon's National Guard Force, the 41st Infantry Division, was federalized in 1940 in anticipation of hostilities. It was the first American division to go overseas after the declaration of war.
Wow.
The first in the entire country. It served longer overseas than any other division. It was the first trained for jungle warfare. Fought in more campaigns than any other. Killed and captured more enemy in the Pacific Theater than any other too. It fought mainly in New Guinea and southern Philippines as part of the island hopping operation. In one campaign, it fought continuously for 76 days. It earned the name Jungleers. And now known as the Sunset Division. There's more information here, son, but I was impressed with the information of learning this. I might add that I didn't know all these things. I was born in Oregon. I thought I was well educated. About 90% of these facts were all new to me. And I kept wondering, why didn't everybody in my education tell me these things? I'll give you one little homely example. I grew up down in Eugene. We'd go over to the coast, and I knew there were the sea lion caves there, and I knew there were a tourist attraction. What nobody ever told me was that of all the sea caves in the world, it is the largest one. The largest in the world, right here. Why didn't they tell me these big, meaningful things? I just don't understand it.
I didn't know. I grew up here and I didn't know that either. I've been there.
And there are lots of them. Well, if you're interested, I have something here where I have additional things that have been dug out. But I don't want to stop you from asking more questions, but do you want to hear a few more?
Yes.
All right. I gave you two of them. Let's see. Oregon was the first state to establish Labor Day as a holiday, which it did on February 21st, 1887. Other states quickly followed: New York, New Jersey, Massachusetts, and Colorado. But Oregon began it all. Portland is also, let me switch around a lot. Nation's first city to remove a freeway, the Harbor Drive Freeway, which was removed in 1974 and turned into a park. Here's something. Let me see here. Oh, well, I'll come to that. Oregon was the first state to come up with the idea of assisted living for retirees, started in 1981, developed in Portland by Dr. Karen Brown Wilson for her frail mother, and still one of three states with the most such care facilities. Started here. And Oregon is was one of three states to begin the practice of painting a center line down the middle of roads to separate lanes. They were Michigan, Oregon, and California. And we may have been the first one to paint it yellow. So,
why was the freeway decommissioned?
Pardon?
Why was the freeway decommissioned?
Well, Tom McCall did it, but the mayor of Portland at that time was enthusiastic backer of it, and it was a growing feeling at that time that the planning for Oregon's valuable waterfronts, which were completely misused from the beginning, they were port-related facilities, and then they turned into junkyards, and then industrial facilities, and then freeways, and at that time there was a rebellion here that, look, we've just done this completely wrong, it's backward, we're gonna get rid of that and start the right process going. Of course, that's a point of view, but it prevailed, and started, and you know, some others did it too. Well, I'll stop there. Anything else you'd like to talk about?
I think everybody ought to buy his book.
I'll run out of books, but I've got a few up here, and I can order more. I've got bookmarks too, for those of you who'd like a reminder, in case you want to get it later.
Did you write other? Don't you have other books that you've written as well?
Yes, I wrote one on history of conservation policy in Oregon. It's called Conserving Oregon's Environment. It won an award for the best nonfiction work in the Northwest in 2013. And I wrote a memoir on my career in the environmental movement and as a CEO of the National Sierra Club, and went all over the country promoting that, called In the Thick of It. And I've got another one in the works right now on quoting a lot of people about leaders in Oregon, their views on nature. And they're all very different, but you see, I'm sort of sticking with a certain theme.
Right.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm in a retirement home myself here, for those of you related to that, but I do this partly because it's being welcomed and I've got these ideas, so I love looking into them.
Yeah. Well, thank you for coming.
Yes.
Okay, so everybody come and buy a book.
I want a book.
And there's cookies up here if you like. And thank you for coming.
They're selling for $19.95. Most people give me $20. I'll be glad to dedicate them.
What form of payment?
Pardon?
What form of payment?
I don't take credit cards, but or cash, checks. It's got lots of color pictures in it too.
Is your bookmark or your bookmark is that detergent with those two?
No, those are great.